Come up to the altar and just worship Him. praise you, O God, because you are a mighty God. You are an awesome God. You are all-knowing God. And we praise you today. We praise you this day on Mother's Day. We thank you today. We thank you, God, because you have provided us mothers. You have given us. You have given us someone who mirrors you. Someone that prays for us and that intercedes for us. We thank you, God, for your mighty hand today, O Lord. We worship you, God. Today we honor you, O Lord. We lift you up today, O God. And we magnify your holy name, O God. We praise you, O God. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you, O God. We praise your name, O God. We give you the praise, Father, O God. Hallelujah. 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 For your mighty hand, O God. For you have a mighty hand, O God. We thank you, O God, for having us in your hands today, O God. Thank you, God, for putting a hand on us today, God.
Regardless of what you heard, you are confident. Brother, hate it not.
Now in your grace.
Thank you. because everything that's not like him is going to come subject to the word of God. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Right there. You're going to stay right here. And I'm going to briefly give you a word this morning. We're not going to release you of this church because I'm getting ready to be very brief. You're going to be a blessing to the mothers on this morning to just encourage them. And then we're going to move forward. We're going to be done in a few minutes. Amen.
Amen.
Our time is already well spent. So we're not going to release you of this church. You've got to sit right here and enjoy. But you can enjoy your mothers on this morning. Amen. Real quickly, get your Bibles. Just be encouraged. somebody get in my hood and just feel blessed. Come on, go give a mother that you don't know a hug and be a blessing to her. Give a mother that you don't know a hug. Encourage your sister. Genesis 16, and we're going to read 7 through 11, and then verse 13. Amen. Everybody there? You working on it? You on your way? I'm reading it in Amplified. Start at verse 7. Genesis chapter 16, verse 7. It says, "But the angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness on the road to Shur. He said, Hagar, Sarah's maid, where did you come from and where were you intended to go? And she said, I am running away from my mistress Sarah. And the angel of the Lord said to her, go back to your mistress and humbly submit to her control. Also, the angel of the Lord said to her, I will multiply your descendants exceedingly so that they shall not be numbered or multitude. And the angel of the Lord continued, see now you are with child and shall bear a son and shall call his name Ishmael, God hears, because the Lord has heard and paid attention to your affliction. Verse 13 says, so she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, you are a God of sin. For she said, now I not even here in the wilderness, look on him who sees me and lives. Or have I here also seen the future purposes or designs of him who sees me? Now, for our title today is Thou God Seest Me. Come on, I need you to say that. Thou God Seest Me. Thou God Seest Me. Come on, I need you to say that, mothers, like you mean it. Thou God Seest Me. You got to know that He sees you. And today is your day. Men, you grab a hold to this because He sees you too. And women that are not mothers, you grab a hold to it because He sees you too. Okay, this is an encouragement for you today. An encouragement to increase your faith. An encouragement to strengthen you. Now, oftentimes when we hear about this passage of scripture, it's always related to, or often related to, Sarah, Abraham's wife, giving her maid servant to her husband to have a child, because up to this point, Sarah had given Abram no children. Abram, because at this time, God had not yet changed his name to Abraham, so right now, he's Abram, okay? So she had not borne any children as of yet. So, being that God had promised Abram that his servant would not be the heir to his fortune, but that Abram would have a child, a son, God promised him that He would give him a son that came from his own loins, from his own body. And so her husband, which wasn't out of the ordinary custom back then. When a wife was barren or she wanted to have more children, she would give her husband her servant. So it wasn't out of the ordinary, it wasn't out of the norm, it was customary during that time. However, that was not God's plan for Sarah and Abraham. Amen? So with that being said, Sarah gave Hagar, is her name, to Abel to marry, saying that maybe this is the way God is going to cause us to have a child. And so with all of that in mind, we're not going to focus on, because you always hear about Isaac, the child, and the promise. That's not going to be our focus today. We want to focus on Hagar. Okay, we're going to talk about her, the maid servant. Amen?
Okay.
And that's what I want you to picture today, all right? I want you to look at yourself as a king guy. Amen? Okay, so we have here, first of all, the scripture where it starts off with Genesis 16 and 8. It says that he said, "Hey God, Sarah's maid, where did you come from and where are you intended to go?" She said, "I am running away from my mistress, Sarah." So why is Hagar running away from Sarah, her mistress? Now, first of all, let me tell you what a mistress is. Because in our mindset, when we hear mistress, we always think of it in the sense of a man who has a mistress, a woman that he keeps, or a woman that he has extra sexual relationship with, that's not his wife. Amen? When you hear mistress, that's what you think about. But a mistress, actually, even in that time, in the original Hebrew meaning, when this was translated, a mistress meant a lady, a queen, or a owner of a servant. Amen? A woman who governs. Even in our today English definition of a mistress, which a lot of us don't know because we use mistress as the other woman. But a mistress is actually a woman who has power, authority, or ownership. Okay? It's the female head of a household, a woman who employs or supervises servants, a woman who is in charge of an establishment. So even if you look that up in the Webster Dictionary, the word mistress is going to tell you that it's a woman in a position of authority. There is a second definition of the one that we always think about, a mistress as being the other woman. But in this case here, the mistress is the one. Amen? And so Hagar was running from her mistress, the woman in court. So why was she running from her? Now, first of all, and I need you I'm bridging this over so you can think about yourself. When, first of all, this mistress, Sarah, she decided she was going to do this to aid God and make it what happened. So now she chooses Hagar. Now, how many times have you been in, relate yourself to Hagar, how many times have you been in a position where you were just doing what you were supposed to do and somebody called you or pulled you out to do something or tell you or to give you something that is seemingly supposed to be good for you, supposed to be a benefit for you? Okay, so Sarah, the mistress, called Hagar and have her to go with her husband so that she can have this child. So what happened when she becomes pregnant? When she becomes pregnant, she now moves from the stand of a servant. Well, come on, I'm helping us out, women. You know, sometimes when promotion comes, we help y'all out without looking at me. Let me bring it down around. Where you understand? When promotion comes, or when that thing that you've been believing God for, when it show up, when you get that man you've been praying for, and you're the first one out the bunch of all five of y'all, and yours came. So when that thing showed up for you, so in Hagar's case, she didn't ask for this, but now it showed up, and so now she's pregnant. So what Hagar did was had a little haughtiness going on in her heart. Okay? So she was a little, she lowered her mistress in her estimation now. Because in her mind, maybe she's thinking, well, she's been married to him all this time, and she ain't been born him no kids yet. I got it on the first spot. I don't know if it's the first time. I'm just bringing her so y'all can see. So she already, she got a baby.
Doesn't even exist, that you do not want to deal with. know when you had a little haughtiness in your heart, but yet he sees the potential and he knows. He wants you to go back and submit to what he's calling you to do. Don't even raise your hand. How many of you out there know that God is telling you to do something and you're running? You know that God is telling you to do something and you run. He's saying, go back and submit to what I'm saying to do, Hagar. Go back and submit to your mistress. In this case, you're going to submit to God and to whomever he's given to be in that position of authority, that position of leadership. Go back, return. Why? Because he sees you and he has kind intentions toward you. He wants something good for you, but it requires you to go back. So you don't want to boast in your attitude when a little something happened. He gave you to endure whatever harsh treatment you may believe you're receiving. And sometimes the treatment that we get, not as harsh as what we think it is. So he says, go back. And when you do that, he says, God sees you. He told Hagar in verse 10, he said, also the angel of the Lord said to her, I will multiply your descendants exceedingly so that they shall not be numbered for multitude. So what he's telling her here, he's not even dealing with the issue at hand. So see, sometimes we be so caught up in what had happened was, and we get on the phone and we call everybody and tell them what had happened was. And God is not concerned about that right now. He wants you to get up and move on, mama. Stop telling everybody that he a deadbeat dad. Stay off the phone with that. Stop talking about how long, how much he won't give you, how much he won't help. But what is God telling you to do? So first of all, you know, whether the baby is here in wedlock or out of wedlock, in whatever case, the baby is here now, okay? So whatever the reason, Hagar is now in the position that she's in, whether she asked for it or not. So now that she's in the position, he says, go back. Okay, you're in the position now. So don't get caught up and calling everybody or talking about him. He says, go back. Why? Because I see you. I have potential for you. He says, I am going to multiply your descendants. What things are you believing God for? What is he saying to you today that he's going to multiply in your life? What is he going to increase for you? So it requires you to go back. He says, I see you. Now then in verse 13, she says, so she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her. So picture this, the place that you're in, the place of the wilderness that you're in, where you are, with everything that's going on, how you think you have messed up, how many times you think you messed up, mama. But mamas can mess up. Mama's not perfect. Your children are an assignment to you.
Amen.
God lent them to you to take care of them.
Amen.
And you don't have all the answers. You don't know all the answers. You don't know how to be the perfect wife, as we use the word perfect. You don't know how to be the perfect employee or employer. Whatever you do, you're going to mess up.
Amen.
So now that you have messed up, he said, go back. Go back to the thing that you know to do. Return to the word of God. Why? Because he sees you. He sees you. So now we have Hagar. She comes to herself. She comes to her senses. She says, I'm out here in the desert, and even in the state that I'm wasn't all of that, y'all say, in a bag of chips. She knew that she had some stuff going on in her heart. But to think that God see her right there in the desert, right there where she is, because he cares for her. She says, wow, you are the living God that sees. Picture him seeing you right where you are. Were you at this thing so devastating to you? He see you. He see you right where you are, and he's reaching his hand out. Happy Mother's Day. He see you, and he got kind intentions toward you. He see you in the midst of your situation, in the midst of your tribulation, in the midst of your desires. But some of you say, I don't have no trials and tribulations going on right now. I'm happy right now. But you have desires in your heart, and it seems like you've been overlooked, and it seems like God has not been paying attention to you, and it seems like you've been doing for everybody else, but nobody is doing for you. It seems like everybody around you is getting the things that they've been believing for, but you're still waiting. God said, I see you. He said, I see you. I see you. What do you desire? What do you want? Don't be scared to ask him. He said, I see you. I see. Thou God seest me. You got to believe that. He sees you.
Tell yourself, thou God seest me. You gotta believe that. And you care about the things that you are concerned about. Hallelujah.
know that he sees you, and it's just too far for you. But that she was a place today in which to come. Some of us have a hard time really believing that God sees us. That's why it's important.